What's up, you guys? It's Graham here. So admittedly, I went down a bit of an internet rabbit hole this week and came across several very alarming economic articles, trends, and studies that I think are worth discussing. There's a lot of them, and I don't even know where to begin because this is just the tip of the iceberg. We've had companies issuing shares at a record pace to cash in on the recent stock market rally, Wells Fargo stopped making loans to independent car dealerships, half of millionaires believe our recession is going to last longer than the Great Recession of 2008 and have been cutting back on their spending, home prices have gone up but are soon expected to drop, half of CFOs expect the Dow to retrace back down to $19,000, what this means for our worst case scenario. And to top all of that off, a California man was arrested for breaking into a bank to heat up a Hot Pocket, but he says it was worth it. I'll cover that one at the end of the video, I promise. Anyway, instead of covering each of these topics individually as their own video, especially the guy with the Hot Pockets, I thought it would be more interesting to summarize the most important parts all in one video, because all of these are gonna have an impact on the future of your money, what this means for the future of our economy, and whether or not we're setting ourselves up for another stock market drop. Except the Hot Pocket guy, I'll be honest, that has nothing to do with your money, I just found it to be a really interesting story that I wanted to share. So with that said, if you appreciate me summarizing everything you need to know in one neatly packaged, condensed YouTube video with a few bad jokes thrown in that hopefully make you laugh, if you wouldn't mind just tickling the like button for the YouTube algorithm. That's it, just a tickle today, and once it turns blue, we're good to go. So with that said, thank you so much, and let's begin. Okay, so first things first, let's talk about a few of these headlines that seem a little bit troublesome, especially if it means we could be in for some turbulent times ahead. And that brings us to this. It was found that US companies issued more than $60 billion worth of stock in May, the biggest amount ever as prices rallied from a potential recovery. Or in other words, companies saw the price of their stock going back up and they said,
hey, if people want to buy our stock right now, then that's good. Let's just give them more stock to buy.
It's no different than if you discovered your toilet paper was selling for $500 a roll and you think to yourself, well, you know what, at that price, I may as well sell it if someone is willing to give me $500. Well, in a way, that's exactly what companies are doing too. On the surface, I will admit, it does seem a little bit concerning. Generally, you will only sell something if you feel like the person buying it is going to pay more than what you could do with it. So maybe in a way, this could be perceived that some of the companies feel like their stock price is overvalued and they're using this as an opportunity right now to cash out. But in the bigger picture, this is very common and many companies sell off their shares to raise money now, and it makes sense that they would want to lock in the current price during a rally just in case prices end up going back down. So I gotta say, even though the headline is alarming, it does make sense. By doing this, companies are going to be able to have more cash on hand to weather a downturn, they're going to be selling at a time where everyone else is buying. And even though we could see a stock market drop in the future, it doesn't guarantee that this is a sign of that happening. After all, Tesla did this back in February when their stock price passed $800 a share, and they saw that as an incredible opportunity to load up on a whole bunch of cash before their stock price eventually went back down, and it did end up going back down, but not before going back up again, even higher now than when they offered the shares in the first place. So all of it is rather unpredictable, and it's not necessarily a sign that the market is going to be dropping in price. But it is a sign that companies see value in holding on to more cash right now, and they're finding that now is the best time to do so. And then, of course, if everything goes to plan, they're going to have more cash on hand to weather a downturn and come out ahead more profitable. Or if the market does drop, these companies cashed in at a high price, the average investor gets stuck holding the bag. And that still puts the company in a better position in the future because it means they were able to get more cash. Either way, there is risk, but companies raising money as they should at a time where their stock price is high is to be expected. And that would just be the smart move to take for any companies who are in need of more capital. Next on our doomsday information agenda for the day is a company that is no stranger to headlines, and that would be Wells Fargo and the recent announcement that they'll no longer be issuing auto loans for independent car dealerships. See, prior to the whole illness, Wells Fargo was one of the largest lenders for auto loans. And in the first quarter, their auto loan business grew almost 20% with $6.5 billion in revenue. So why all of a sudden would they stop issuing loans with a business that they have been continually growing? Well, that, ladies and gentlemen, brings us to the auto loan crisis. According to the New York Fed, subprime auto loans and delinquency hit an all-time high this quarter with $68 billion worth of those auto loans more than 90 days late. Ally Bank, who is another very prominent auto lender, said that 25% of their auto loan borrowers asked for a deferral payment and nearly one of five borrowers had enrolled in the deferral program by the end of March. So it's no surprise, that's a huge number and that's very concerning to lenders. Now, what's even more more surprising is that the delinquency rate for prime loans, meaning when someone has a good credit score, remains at a record low, while subprime borrowers with a bad credit score defaulted at a record high. And once you begin digging down the auto loan money pit even further, you can see that the average credit score to buy a new car is 715, but it's 662 for a used auto loan. And that means when Wells Fargo says that they're going to be cutting off their loans to independent car dealerships, that really just means
we don't want to issue any more loans for used car dealerships that generally accept a clientele with a lower credit score, and that in turn for us is more risk.
So instead, Wells Fargo is going to be shifting its resources and catering towards larger car dealerships that take people with a better credit score. This is partially what I discussed in one of my recent videos talking about the major changes taking place for anyone with a credit card. And in that video, I suggested that banks would become more strict about who they give loans to, and that in turn means less growth for our economy as people just have less access to capital. This was to be expected, and as a business, Wells Fargo has to look out for their best interest and the best interest of their millions of fake accounts. See, that was one of those bad jokes I was talking about, because Wells Fargo was found guilty of creating millions of fake accounts, but I'll try again next time. Anyway, this is a smart move for Wells Fargo, but it's a bad sign for the used automotive industry that's already been hit very hard to begin with, and for the foreseeable future, getting a loan is probably going to be a lot more challenging for everybody. But on the bright side, if you're in the market right now for a used car and you got a good credit score, then you could probably negotiate a pretty good deal. But wait, it doesn't end there. Another study was just published which found that millionaires plan to cut down on their spending this year and delay making any big purchases for another year, combined with their average belief that the market will take another year to recover. Wow, so much to cover with this one, so we'll talk first about the spending, or lack thereof. The study found that almost half of all millionaires surveyed said that they plan to spend less this summer than in previous years, 25% of them intend to postpone a real estate purchase, and 15% intend to postpone the purchase of a car. But the more I read into this, the more I realized that it doesn't sound like this is from a lack of finances, but instead to be able to keep more cash on hand and take advantage of the current market prices. What I actually found really surprising was that 75% of millionaires' incomes have not been affected by the illness, and the majority of those surveyed said that they would expect their asset prices to be the same or higher by the end of the year. I think this could be partially due to the diversity of the average millionaire's income. And even though I can't find the definitive source of where this actually came from, it is estimated that the average millionaire has 7 different sources of income. Given that, I think it's reasonable that during a crisis, even if one or two of those income streams were hit, most millionaires would have several other income streams that would continue paying out unaffected, including their investments. And given the recent rally in the stock market, it's not surprising why a lot of those millionaires believe their assets would be the same level or even higher at this current rate. And really, all things considered, I'm not concerned about this statistic. It's not surprising why anyone would hold off temporarily from making a purchase. I think it's a smart thing to do. Not only does that give you a bigger safety net, but it also gives you more cash on hand to redeploy back into the market if you see good opportunity. Especially if they believe the market is going to take another year to recover, which brings me to this. Anytime you don't have a crystal ball, but you want to try to predict and figure out what's going to happen, that's easy. All you got to do, apparently, is ask 750 millionaires. Because when surveyed, nearly two-thirds of them said that it would take the market at least a year to recover back to its previous all-time high. Now, even though this sounds like it could be somewhat bad news, in a way, I actually think it's good news. And I interpret this as rather optimistic that the market would rebound so quickly. And even though it says they only plan to put about a third of their money into stocks, it's actually a significant amount of money, with the majority of those millionaires reinvesting and buying into the market drop. It was reported that only 17% reduced their positions as the stock market bottomed, and 11% sold out entirely. And I understand the logic behind it. When you look at the stock market fundamentals, you see a stock market that is entirely disconnected from reality. So logically, we shouldn't be trading so high. But it's very important to recognize that the stock market is not a reflection of the economy, and never before have we had such an extreme amount of stimulus just directly injected right into the markets. Combined with historically low interest rates, nowhere else to invest your money right now, and a very sudden drop from an illness that should overall begin to disappear as soon as a vaccine is offered, so when you combine all of that, it's no wonder that the market is going to begin lifting back up. Overall, I think it's really important to mention that market timing is nearly impossible, and despite what some millionaires think, look at what they're doing. They're cutting back, they're saving money, they're reinvesting back into the markets, and they're smashing the like button for the YouTube algorithm. So that is what I would recommend as well. But the average CFO may not necessarily agree with that, and 51% of them believe the Dow will fall another 20% down to 19,000 before hitting its next new all-time high. With, by the way, only 1 of 5 global CFOs believing that we could hit a new market high without retesting the previous low back in March. Now, this article did have way too too much statistic jargon in there, but here's what I found interesting. The article said that many market observers have argued that the recent stock market rally is hard to square with economic reality, that stocks are, in fact, divorced from real economic conditions. Now, in my opinion, as some dude who spends way too much time talking to himself in front of a camera, I think this thinking makes sense. I think any rational, numbers-driven person can look at the stock market right now, compare it to where we were a year ago, make the connection with our current economic environment, which is terrible, and then make the conclusion that we should not be trading at these levels right now and that we are overvalued. And let me make it clear, if they think that, I think they would be right. Seriously, the Dow is trading at the same level as it was 10 months ago, and no way is our economy as healthy as it was back then. But there is an element to the market that is completely irrational, and a lot of money has shifted towards online companies with a very big presence. And instead of trying to go against it, it's better to be cautious, make sure you have a stable source of income, and then invest consistently for the long run. That way you're not just holding a bunch of cash on the sidelines and missing out on the recent rally, but you're also not impulsively buying in and trying to time the market perfectly right. And that's really where I think the disconnect is between the market fundamentals and what's going on right now with the stock market. Because that brings us to real estate, and home prices in April saw their biggest gain in 2 years. Wait a second, is that right? They saw their biggest gain in 2 years. Then how are prices supposed to be going down at the end of the year? Well, the reason prices went up in the first place is just due to a lack of supply, similar to toilet paper. If there's a shortage of toilet paper and in your entire city there's only 1,000 rolls available, guaranteed the price of the toilet paper would go up. Likewise, if there's a surplus of too much toilet paper and people just need to dump it, pun intended, then that means people will take a lower price just to get rid of it, and the same thing applies to real estate. See, sellers have chosen to temporarily hold off from listing their homes in the market, and that has caused a sharp decrease in inventory, meaning the price for what is on the market right now begins going up as there is more demand than there is supply. Combine all of that with record low interest rates, and you have the perfect storm. However, the decline could potentially come as more sellers begin listing their homes for sale, especially in very hard-hit tourism cities like Las Vegas and Miami. And we might also see a drop in home prices as the reality sets in that maybe not as many jobs are coming back as we expect. I've made a video about this before, but generally real estate prices tend to lag behind everything else. And it's probably going to take us about 6 months to end up seeing what's really going on today. So even though there is some optimism here, it's definitely something to be made aware of. In a worst case scenario though, things might end up looking quite different, especially if people end up leaving expensive cities, they work remotely, they relocate to inexpensive areas and ditch retail. But even in that situation with a mass migration, what would end up happening is that that would drive up real estate prices elsewhere that didn't see a demand previously. So overall, I think we're likely to see real estate prices remain fairly stable. And lastly, I know this is a story you guys have all been waiting for, so I saved the best for last. A man was arrested for breaking into a bank to heat up a Hot Pocket, and he said it was worth it. Funny enough, the bank that was broken into was a Wells Fargo, which is the same company that stopped issuing auto loans to independent car dealerships. And according to a reporter who was interviewing him as he was being arrested, she asked him if it was worth it, and his response was, yeah, it was worth it. Yes, it was worth it. A Hot Pocket? Yeah. Listen, I'm not gonna lie. Honestly, Hot Pockets are pretty good. I am personally fond of the cheeseburger flavor myself, and if you think this might be a sign to go and invest in Hot Pockets, well, you can. They're owned by Nestle, which is a publicly traded company, and I have to say, when you take a deeper look into the company, it's actually pretty impressive. They have very little volatility, they have very strong, consistent growth. What's not to like? Now sure, unfortunately, they have to go and rename the Incredible Burger to something else because it was found out they infringed on the rights of the Impossible Burger name. But despite that, they got Hot Pockets, and if this man believes in them so much to break into a bank, then it might be worth looking into further. I can't say that without a straight face, but seriously, he might have a point. So overall, there's your weekly update, everything you need to know in one place, and very important information about Hot Pockets. Even though the headlines are scary, including mine, it does come with the realization that at the end of the day, no one knows what's going to happen, and the best thing you could do is just this. One, during times of uncertainty, it never hurts to cut back on your spending and save up more cash. Two, don't ever panic and try to time the market. Instead, just consistently buy in and hold long term. Three, also do your best to diversify your income as much as you can. The more income streams you're able to make for yourself, the more insulated you'll be in case one of those fails. And number four, more important than everything else, make sure to smash the like button for the YouTube algorithm. So with that said, you guys, thank you so much for watching. I really appreciate it. As always, make sure to destroy the subscribe button and the notification bell. Also, feel free to add me on Instagram. I post here pretty much daily, so if you want to be a part of it there, feel free to add me there, as on my second channel, The Graham Stephan Show. I post there every single day I'm not posting here. So if you want to see a brand new video from me every single day, make sure to add yourself to that, as on my podcast. Link down below in the description. And lastly, if you guys want two free stocks, use the link down below in the description. Webull is going to be giving you two free stocks when you deposit $100 on the platform, with one of the stocks potentially being valued up to $1,400. So if you want a chance to get two free stocks with one of them valued to a lot of money, make sure to use the link down below in the description. Let me know which two free stocks you get. Thank you so much for watching, and until next time.